Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Critical Thinking Skills for Dummies by Martin Cohen, narrated by Eric Martin. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. Critical thinking. Now that sounds like a good idea. Because it's a kind of souped-up, laser-sharp, powerful thinking, just waiting to zap rotten arguments and churn out some pretty brilliant insights instead. And don't worry if people tell you that it is a rather high-level kind of thinking, and that only a few can do it, mainly tweedy professors who tell jokes in Latin. Dimidium facti qui coepit abet. He who has begun has the work half done. Because critical thinking certainly isn't like that. Critical thinking is not just for the tweedy few, but for the curious, the imaginative, the creative many. In fact, the only thing that is really deeply mysterious about critical thinking is why everyone's not doing it. But I've got a theory about that, and it is to do with education and the kind of ways of working that people are corralled into like so many sheep, supposedly as a preparation for life outside. But life outside is rarely just a business of unreflectively following set procedures and instructions, but rather something where you need constantly to reflect on what you are doing and why, and act not as a machine, but as a person. So, the first skill a critical thinker needs to learn is how to think the unthinkable, to think outside the box, to free their mind, no less. Sounds idealistic? A bit 60s and hippies wearing flowers? Well, yes, there's a bit of idealism in critical thinking, just as there is in all the best things, but there's also a lot of structure and solid research backing it, too. This book will give you what you need of both, plus plenty of opportunities to develop and test your own skills. I've done both my bit of being taught and of teaching over the years, and another rather mysterious thing is why so many people seem to imagine that thinking, let alone critical thinking, is something that can be learned by rote, that is, by writing down and memorizing a collection of facts, a body of knowledge, with right and wrong answers. Critical thinking guides that create obscure distinctions and list technical terms for you to learn are promoting passive, not active, thinking. Rote learning is fine if all you ever intend to do is deal with past problems, but won't get you many new insights or ideas. And in fact, it is the opposite of what critical thinking is all about. Critical thinking is really a set of transferable skills, learned for one thing, equally useful for another, that cuts across the whole swath of academic disciplines and is applicable in all spheres of human activity. This is why you will find critical thinking useful as part of learning design skills, nursing studies, economics, and even playing good football. It really is a toolbox for making the most of life. About this book. In this book, you can find both the conventional material on critical thinking skills, which is broadly about avoiding logical fallacies and following the rules of good essay structure, and a lot more besides. Most other books focus on these bits of critical thinking because they are easy to talk about, but rather harder to actually get anyone to do. In fact, like philosophy itself, and critical thinking is traditionally a branch of philosophy, properly understood, the only way to learn the method is to use the skills in practice. So what I try to offer here is a kind of map or guidebook that will come in handy as you actively start using critical thinking in whatever areas you want to. I include enough of the background to the academic debates for you to see the why as well as the what, plenty of hands-on tips and advice so that you have the how, and I certainly include some opportunities to try things out in practical exercises. Foolish assumptions. One of the key skills in critical thinking that too often gets overlooked is knowing your audience, and indeed empathizing with them. In this case, that means understanding what motivates them. So as I write this book, just as when you write an essay or prepare a report, the crucial thing is to know what the interests and needs of the likely listener are. I assume that you are interested in ideas and in how to communicate them. Already know there is a difference between critical thinking and just criticizing without thinking. Want to be able to see through a bad argument. Know how to construct a persuasive argument, although I don't make any assumptions about what you will be arguing about or the context that you are studying or working within. Whether you're young or old, male or female, an engineer or a philosopher, makes no difference to me. The book is zero jargon and open access. You could be a CEO or the Prime Minister, but you won't get special sections for that reason. However, I do anticipate that you might be a student, perhaps starting your studies or perhaps having progressed to the point where you are being asked to produce longer dissertations, because, believe it or not, critical thinking is a skill that even PhD students often fall short in. This thinking gap is behind a lot of dodgy research and public policy all over the world. So really, I also assume that the likely listener has a moral purpose too. You want to think better and more clearly to get things right, not just know enough to pass the exam. On the other hand, if you are sort of a reluctant critical thinker, heck, let me have a go at converting you. Because I know there is an awful lot of boring stuff out there on informal logic and structuring essays, and I certainly don't intend to add to it here. So, if you are starting off by wanting just the minimum to pass, you've still come to the right place. If critical thinking is sometimes a diet of thoroughly stodgy skills, here you should find plenty of flavoring has been added to the stew that makes it all much more tasty. Icons used in this book. A closer look. I use this icon to point you towards more detailed explanations of important ideas or theories that shed light on critical thinking techniques and skills. Jargon Buster. There's a lot of jargon used in some critical thinking circles. I attach this icon near the plain English explanation of a term. Remember, I use this icon to highlight key facts and ideas that, literally, you may want to remember. If you know it already, sometimes it will come across more as a reminder. Tip. This flags up a simple idea that can be used to achieve both academic critical thinking aims, how to dissect an argument, for example, and also broader CT skills, such as how to give space to other people to develop their ideas, rather than switch off at the first point of disagreement. Try this. And last, but definitely not least, this one flags up an opportunity for you to try your skills out. Warning. I reserve this scary icon to indicate both practical pitfalls and theories that have downsides. Beyond the book. In addition to the material in the print or ebook you're listening to right now, this product also comes with some Access Anywhere goodies on the web. Check out the free cheat sheet at dummies.com/cheat-sheet/critical-thinking for some helpful tips and hints. You can also access some fun critical thinking exercises at dummies.com/extras/critical-thinking. Where to go from here? You can listen to this book any way you want. I don't mind if you just try a few bits that seem particularly relevant, or if you plow through the whole thing in one evening and take it to bed with you, or if you skim it while eating chips and watching TV. In fact, I'd recommend that you don't treat it as a textbook, with lesson one leading to lesson two, because the smart listener knows, and the critical thinker is a smart listener, that information is best digested when it connects to something you have a current, real need to know. Only you can say what it is at the moment you're looking at, or thinking about, or interested in. However, if you want my advice about where to start, and why not, I wrote the book, so I ought to know a bit about it, I'd say some good places to go are Chapter 1, because that is where I welcome you to the Arguments Clinic and say a bit about what critical thinking is. Chapter 4, which is on assessing your thinking skills, because it contains a pretty cool test of the kind that evil employers may give you, and is quite fun, too. But don't listen to it for that reason, because all of the book is fun. Chapter 9, Getting to the Heart of the Reading Matter, another possible jumping-in point. It sounds a bit serious, but it's also a good place to start, as it is through reading that most people get new ideas and develop their views. Don't forget, that's probably why you're listening to this book in the first place. What could be better than just listening to this book, than listening to it while thinking critically? Part 1. Getting Started with Critical Thinking Skills. Web Extras. For Dummies can help you get started with lots of subjects. Go to www.dummies.com to learn more and do more with For Dummies. In this part, find a quick overview of what this newfangled idea called critical thinking is really all about and why everyone's doing it. Measure your existing thinking skills and get a big nudge towards broadening your outlook to include emotional intelligence and awareness of everyone's inbuilt biases. Discover why most people's brains are happier reaching quick answers than they are at reaching the right answers, plus tips on how to avoid that tendency for yourself. Learn how unscrupulous folks, from political extremists to talented advertisers, have always taken advantage of uncritical thinkers. Chapter 1. Entering the Exciting World of Critical Thinking. In this chapter, getting the big picture on thinking skills, picking up cool tips for problem solving, steering clear of common misconceptions. There goes another beautiful theory about to be murdered by a brutal gang of facts. François VI, Duc de la Rochefoucauld, French writer and moralist, 1613 to 1680. Critical thinking is about pressing points, sniffing a bit more skeptically at issues, and generally looking more closely at everything. Not only at factual claims, but also, and most importantly, at the ways in which people arrive at their views and ideas. Harumph, you may think. Why bother? Good question. I've failed plenty of job interviews in my time by being a critical thinker. Equally, the world has no shortage of successful people who scrupulously avoid any appearance of not only thinking critically, but thinking full stop. My short answer is that being a critical thinker is still the best kind of thinker to be, even if it does sometimes mean that you're the odd one out on many issues. In this chapter, I provide an overview of critical thinking and what you can find in the rest of this book. I'll also cover the importance of reading between the lines and also set the record straight on what critical thinking isn't. Opening the doors to the Arguments Clinic. You may well have been brought up not to argue. At school, you were probably encouraged to sit quietly and write down facts. I was. When I was 5, one teacher even used sticky tape to shut children's mouths up in class. Yes, I was one of them. Since then, I've had some very enlightened teachers who encouraged me to use my imagination to solve some problems or do research, but still not to argue. So, welcome to a very different way of seeing the world, critical thinking. This is truly the arguments clinic in which punters can pay for either 5-minute or hour-long arguments, as the famous Monty Python sketch has it. No, it isn't. Yes, it is. Still say that it isn't? But yes, it is. If you like, check out Chapter 17 now to discover 10 of the world's most influential arguments. Don't worry, I'll still be here when you get back. Of course, as the sketch says, this isn't proper argument at all, merely contradiction. Nothing like a connected series of statements intended to establish a proposition. If an ability to contradict people is all you come away with after listening to this book, then you, like the man in the sketch, would be entitled to your money back. Don't worry. Here you will find so many new ways of looking at issues that you'll soon be having the full hour-long arguments on everything under the sun. My aim by the end of this section is to give you the big picture of critical thinking. Defining critical thinking. If you look up critical thinking in a dictionary, you see that it's called the philosophical examination of arguments, and I'm a philosopher. But, at the risk of annoying the ivory tower experts straight away, I say that this kind of philosophy isn't the sort most of them do or have a clue about. Yes, as chapter 12 shows, critical thinking does have one foot in the realm of logic, in tidily setting out arguments as premises followed by conclusions, but if that were all it was, you might as well give the job to a computer. Remember, no, critical thinking is really about a range of skills and understandings, including an ability to play with words, a sensitivity to context, feelings, and emotions, and, the hardest skill to develop, the kind of open-mindedness that allows you to make creative leaps and gain insights. I know that developing these skills sounds rather like a tall order for one book to achieve, but critical thinking is also team thinking, and I draw on the ideas of many other thinkers, including a lot of input from my editors at Wiley. As a result, you don't get my opinion of critical thinking skills, but a carefully researched and lively introduction to the subject. Spotting how the brain likes to think. Professors may sniff, but I prefer to work on exercises that are fun or interesting, which is why I have tried hard to make the ones in this book like that. Here's a rather trivial little exercise, which nonetheless illustrates something important about how the human mind operates. Try this. Should you say, "The yolk of the egg is white," or "The yolk of the egg are white"? When I first saw this question, I thought for a minute, and then I gave up and looked for the answers. That's my method with written exercises. It conserves my limited brain power for things like watching TV and eating crisps at the same time. But I digress. Not good in critical thinking. This question may form the subject of a 5-minute argument, but it shouldn't stretch to an hour, because neither version is correct. Egg yolks are yellow. Boom! Boom! Caught you out? This exercise reveals that people's normal mode of thinking is bound within the parameters of certain rules and systems due to thousands of years of evolution. In the jargon of psychology, human thinking uses certain heuristics, mental shortcuts for solving problems and making judgments quickly. Warning. The trouble is that automatic and well-established ways of thinking can stop you from seeing new possibilities or avoiding unexpected pitfalls. Plus, the great majority of people's thinking goes on without them being aware of it. Although sometimes quick and efficient, in certain circumstances it can rush people to the wrong conclusions. Critical thinking is your insurance policy against these dodgy, but more or less universal, thinking habits. Evaluating what you read, hear, and think. The fundamental cause of the trouble is that in the modern world, the stupid are cocksure, while the intelligent are full of doubt. Bertrand Russell, The Triumph of Stupidity in Mortals and Others, Bertrand Russell's American Essays, 1931 to 1935. Ingredients that make a critical thinker. If you're building a critical thinker, a la Dr. Frankenstein, here are the abilities and attributes you need. Tolerance. Critical thinkers delight in hearing divergent views and enjoy a real debate. Analytical skills. Critical thinkers don't accept just any kind of talking. They want properly constructed arguments that present reasons and draw sound conclusions. Confidence. Critical thinkers have to be a little bit confident to be able to examine views that others present, often people in authority. Curiosity. Critical thinkers need curiosity. It may have killed the cat, but curiosity is the essential ingredient for ideas and insights. Truth-seeking. critical thinkers are on mission objective truth, even if it turns out to undermine their own previously held convictions and long-cherished beliefs and is flat against their self-interest. Tip: critical thinking is about actively questioning not only the conclusions of what you're reading or hearing, but also the assumptions, be they open or hidden, and the overall frame of reference. Critical reading is discussed in detail in Chapter 9. A closer look. Critical thinkers approach an issue without preconceived assumptions, let alone prejudices, towards certain conclusions. As Professor Stella Cottrell, author of a popular guide to the subject, says, critical thinkers are quite prepared to acknowledge a good argument that goes against them and will refuse to resort to a bad argument, even if it looks like the only one available to support them. Developing critical thinking skills, reading between the lines. The improver of natural knowledge absolutely refuses to acknowledge authority as such. For him, skepticism is the highest of duties, blind faith the one unpardonable sin. And it cannot be otherwise, for every great advance in natural knowledge has involved the absolute rejection of authority, the cherishing of the keenest skepticism. Thomas Huxley, On the Advisableness of Improving Natural Knowledge, 1866. Critical thinkers know that real debates take place between the lines, and all too often under the mental radar. The critical thinker's job is to pull the real issues into plain view and, if necessary, shoot them down. I introduce you here to some of the core skills of critical thinking: reading between the lines, examining the evidence, and quickly deconstructing texts. The chapters in Part 3 provide loads more info on how to do just that. Challenging people's rationality. Do you know people whose views don't seem to be based on any sort of rational assessment of the world, but rather on dodgy information easily imbibed, or even on blatant prejudices? Me too. And what's more, at least some of my views, and some of your views, also fall into this rather illogical category. The fact is, even though Aristotle called men, not women, he was emphatically prejudiced, rational animals, people rarely use their rational facility in practice. I discuss this subject in more depth in Chapter 13. More subtly, people often present good reasons for their positions, but in reality arrive at their views for quite different ones. The good reasons are irrelevant, as you sometimes find out if you present some solid arguments that tend to disprove them. For example, suppose your neighbors buy a four-wheel drive all-terrain car and insist that it is vital for when the family goes mountaineering and camping. Yet the fact is that they rarely go anywhere more remote than the nearest supermarket and hate getting their shiny car dirty. Could the real reason be that having a tank-sized car bolsters their sense of self-importance? Or maybe the government says that it has to charge students tuition fees, otherwise there won't be enough money for everyone who wants to go to college in the future. Good reason. Odd, then, that the fees system actually costs more to operate than the previous universal grants system. Could the real reason for the change be something to do with dismantling the political edifice of the welfare state? Arguments may exist for doing that, too, but that's straying into politics. I'm not saying one way or the other, but I am recommending the habit of looking a little harder at the reasons and explanations people give. Dipping into the critical thinking skills toolbox. I think of critical thinking as a toolbox. Philosophers have a long tradition of seeing argument skills as tools. Remember, critical thinking isn't one tool, but lots. Plus, its skills can do a lot more than most of its experts seem to be aware of, because most of them come from too narrow a base. Totting up Aristotle's tools. The most famous writings on how to argue are the 2,000-year-old books of Aristotle. His followers gathered them together and called the collection Organon, which is Greek for tool. Interestingly, this title reflects a controversy at the heart of philosophy that has never gone away. Is logic the purest form of philosophy, or merely a tool that philosophers use? So this obscure bit of ancient Greek is surprisingly political, taking sides in an educational controversy that continues to rage today. Tip: logic is a central critical thinking tool. You can see the kind of logic that it uses as a mental screwdriver with two different purposes. It enables you to take arguments completely apart and mend and reassemble them. Critical thinking also has creative uses, such as prototyping and brainstorming, see chapters 6 and 7 respectively. These hammer and nails skills, with plenty of glue added in, are great for creating new solutions and visualizing possibilities. Plus, don't forget the social and emotional components of critical thinking, which I cover in chapters 3 and 4 respectively. I like to think of these as the measuring tools in the kit, maybe as the spirit level too. Remember, philosophical and mathematical logic is a solitary process. One person or computer can take on the world. After churning through a formal proof and finding a contradiction, the matter is closed. But critical thinking involves questioning, challenging arguments, methods, ideas, and findings, demanding the context and the background. Therefore, it's a more sociable business, where people explore and create truths collectively. Ordering your thinking: reason, analyze, and then argue. Remember, in that order, please. Uncritical thinkers may start by arguing and then pause to analyze and finally search for reasons, but making the argument follow the reasoning, not the other way around, is much better. Which logic for critical thinking? You can encounter plenty of types of logics: classical logic, Boolean logic, quantum logic, sentential logic, and how about a bit of multi-valued logic or predicate logic too, sprinkled with fuzzy logic? No. Breathe again. Critical thinking isn't a sneaky way to make students study logic. It's not even a form of logic light. A fundamental difference exists between all the usual logics and the one that critical thinkers include as one of their tools: informal logic. All the other logics are concerned with the form of the arguments, but only informal logic, as the name suggests, is also concerned with the content of arguments, with issues and applications. Philosophers prefer to see critical thinking as a course in informal logic, the study of arguments expressed in natural language, where an argument being valid isn't enough, the conclusion has to be useful, too. The chapters in Part 4 are all about that, and where I take a good look at the key skills of informal logic, for example, the fallacies that many critical thinking experts wax long on. But don't be too excited at the prospect of using logic to conquer the world, because as I explain, its powers are strictly limited. Tip: the difference between a sound argument and a fallacy is often far from black and white, which isn't to imply that people don't make lots of silly mistakes and lousy arguments. Check out some logical pitfalls in Chapter 16. On the other hand, don't let any of these concerns put you off using logic skills in your thinking, writing, check out Chapter 10, and speaking, see Chapters 11 and 14, because a little method can go a long way to making your arguments more persuasive and demonstrating the weaknesses in other people's, too. Researchers have often found that, when asked, people can't really explain why they hold such and such a view or what they think would count as suitable evidence for the view. Even more worrying for society is that these same people are extremely reluctant to have their views challenged. Critical thinking skills are your antidote to this very common disease. Discovering what kind of thinking you do. The one primary and fundamental law of mental action consists in a tendency to generalization. Feeling tends to spread. Connections between feelings awaken feelings. Neighboring feelings become assimilated. Ideas are apt to reproduce themselves. These are so many formulations of the one law of the growth of mind. When a disturbance of feeling takes place, we have a consciousness of gain, the gain of experience. C.S. Peirce, The Architecture of Theories, 1891. The quote is about building on what you already think is vital for future growth, but it brings problems. Remember, a 19th-century American philosopher, Peirce also identified three kinds of thinkers, which I shall summarize here, a little creatively, as follows. 1. Sticklers. People who form their beliefs by tenaciously sticking to whichever view they liked most originally, whatever evidence is presented to them, and even however circumstances change. If asked to justify their view, they can be very thorough in finding facts to support it, while also refusing to look into anything that appears likely to run against it. I write about facts and opinions in Chapter 15. 2. Followers. People who respect anyone or anything that presents itself as authoritative. They form their view in a group discussion on what they think, say, the professor is saying, or, in the absence of an authority figure, on what they imagine is the consensus view. When they look up something on the internet, they head for the security of Wikipedia, as they imagine it, and are reluctant to consult websites run by individuals. These kinds of thinkers, as Peirce says, are useful members of society because they aid social harmony and cohesion, although they may also be found egging on tyrants and persecuting minorities. But they aren't useful as far as ideas go. 3. System builders. These are people who try to fit everything into a pre-existing framework. They're a more sophisticated version of the sticklers. Science is obliged, in practice, to operate on a similar principle. Systemizers are willing to consider new information, but if it requires dismantling the pre-existing structure for understanding the world, they're likely to reject it. You can hear more on how people process information to build knowledge in Chapter 8. Tip. According to Peirce, the smart way to see the world is to accept that everything you know may be wrong and start from scratch if need be, or indeed end up with all the views on an issue demolished with no working hypothesis left. Only a true critical thinker would do such a thing. Almost all professors of the arts and sciences are egregiously conceited and derive their happiness from their conceit. Erasmus. Bertrand Russell ascribes this quote to Erasmus, and I can see why he liked it. Russell was a philosopher prepared to argue unpopular views, such as that war is a bad thing, and was put in prison. Twice. Tip. Russell, refreshingly, took on professors and people in authority, but his point, of course, applies to everyone. Too few people are really open to new ideas, let alone able to take criticism, unless they've taken and really absorbed the lessons of critical thinking. U.S. philosopher William James made a similar point when he complained that many people think that they're thinking when they're merely rearranging their prejudices. For critical thinkers, discerning thought and prejudice is a vital distinction to make, and the first step is becoming more aware of your biases. I examine this issue in Chapter 2. James also recommends that in many areas, people should decide their position on the basis of feelings, even if they have no good or relevant arguments to support it. How logical is that? Well, not at all, but it's not a stupid position either. In Chapter 4, I look at some distinctly non-logical ways of approaching problems. Professors tend to tell people to think and complain when they don't, but they fail to offer advice on exactly how to do it. For that, students have to rely largely on their own efforts, or maybe turn to specialist experts such as Edward de Bono. He stresses that thinking is a skill that has to be learned. Critical thinking definitely owes pioneers of thinking skills like him a polite nod, even if the approach here has to be a little more, well, scientific. Speaking of which, Here's a scientist to explain about how scientists think. The mere formulation of a problem is far more often essential than its solution, which may be merely a matter of mathematical or experimental skill. To raise new questions, new possibilities, to regard old problems from a new angle, requires creative imagination and marks real advances in science. Albert Einstein, A. Einstein and L. Infeld, The Evolution of Physics, 1938, page 92. Well, he has to come in sooner or later. Einstein's point about creativity is absolutely spot on. Thinking outside the box. This anecdote shows how redefining problems can generate new insights. A gardening equipment firm challenged a meeting of engineers to use their collective thinking power to come up with a new kind of lawnmower. After some humming and ahhing, the engineers came up with not very much. Some tinkering and slightly novel refinements, but nothing to create a splash in the marketplace. Then one of the engineers suggested that they return to the original problem, but to go back one step and express it in terms of function. Instead of the engineers thinking about how to redesign lawnmowers, which meant that their thoughts followed the usual paths, he said they should think about machines to help people maintain lawns. This small, even niggly, distinction made all the difference. The engineers even created an entirely new product, based on the imaginative insight of one whose son liked playing with yo-yos. They invented the strimmer, which involves a nylon string whizzing around, thus adding a new annoyance to neighbors everywhere. The power of critical thinking. You can hear more about creative brainstorming in Chapter 7. Understanding what critical thinking isn't. The preceding sections discuss what critical thinking is, but I now detail what it isn't. Remember, critical thinking isn't about putting arguments and debates into formal language or symbols and then spotting logical fallacies in them, despite what many books say. It is about how to look at issues and problems in the real world, with all their fuzziness and contradictions, and offer relevant, practical, and sharp insights into them. It's a skill that lets you, for example, distinguish right from wrong, choose the best business policy, and construct a compelling case for action. Tip. Also, critical thinking is far deeper than study skills, those set ways of doing things that lecturers often teach students. Instead, it's about what to do when no obvious answers or set methods are available. Look at it this way. A study skill makes sure that you have pen and paper during lectures. Critical thinking is about what to jot down. Quantum physicist Richard Feynman said that science is grounded in the conviction that its own experts are often ignorant of what they profess to be experts about. That statement applies, with knobs on, to critical thinking, too. Warning. People who claim to be experts in critical thinking don't automatically know everything about the vast range of skills and material the subject covers or draws upon. Nonetheless, critical thinking is a skill. And so whether you're pretty hot on it or not, you can definitely improve through practice. Critical thinking isn't about learning an endless series of facts. Instead, it encourages people to develop their inbuilt thinking skills by making them active. That's why this book features lots of tricky puzzles. See Chapter 5 for more on puzzles and analogies, rather than platitudes. I want you to start thinking critically and actively from the beginning. Or from the start of Chapter 2, anyway. Chapter 2. Peering into the Mind: How People Think. In this chapter, Testing Humans, Logical Thinking, Staring into the Brain While It Works, Challenging the Notion of Rational Scientific Thinking. We think so because other people all think so, or because we were told so and think we must think so. Henry Sidgwick. Some mysteries are best tackled by digging out and looking at the known facts, but not the issue of how people think. This one is best tackled, as philosophers have done for centuries, by asking questions. For example, when you read something, whose voice do you hear in your head? Is it your own voice as the reader, or is it an echo of the voice of the author reappearing through the words, or perhaps both? The neurologist Paul Brocks identifies a peculiar thing about writing. It seems to allow other people to access and take over the language centers of your brain. Part of this chapter, the section Thinking Logically or Instinctively, Evolution and Consciousness, explains how and why that may happen. Being aware of this is useful when you're trying to understand your reaction both to other people's ideas and to critically evaluate some of your own theories. One of the key skills, not only of critical thinking, but in life generally, is the ability to reflect on your own practices. This chapter is your diagnostic manual for checking what's going on inside your head. In debates about how people think, a gulf in philosophy has long existed between conservatives who uphold traditional distinctions and assume the brain is a machine, and therefore logical and rational, and radicals who critique that whole approach and admire the complexity and illogicality of human thinking. This chapter takes a look at these debates, ones that shape all subject areas, so that you can move towards an effective analysis of your own and other people's reasoning. It's important to realize that even scientists aren't immune to making mistakes in this area. Thinking about how people think. Some thoughts. We think so because other people all think so, or because, after all, we do think so, or because we were told so, and think we must think so, or because we once thought so and think we still think so, or because, having thought so, we think we will think so. Henry Sidgwick. Henry Sidgwick's contribution to understanding how people think, which I started the chapter with, touches upon the key issues, although it's hardly expressed very elegantly. If students wrote like that in exams, they may not fail, but they wouldn't get many marks. It's almost rambling, not clear and authoritative at all. But then, English philosopher Sidgwick didn't write those words at all. You can find plenty of people on the internet saying that he did, but when you look more closely, as critical thinkers always should do, you find that the lines are supposed to be insights that occurred to the great philosopher in his sleep and are, in fact, as recorded by his relatives, Arthur and Eleanor Mildred Sidgwick. They were probably struck by his idea that thinking is not really an individual matter at all, but rather a complex social phenomenon involving lots of different associations, some of them misremembered and some maybe even imaginary. I also examine a more specific question. To what extent do logical rules and the methods of rational argument underlie people's beliefs and the judgments and decisions they make? Or, on the contrary, are individuals more influenced by what other people think? An understanding of this tendency to groupthink provides you with a key defense against being misled by the opinions of those around you or those in authority, and also a more sophisticated way of interpreting events, debates, and decisions. Listen on, but also have a think about what you think about how you think, and then perhaps try not thinking about anything. Maybe have a quiet lie down. Thinking Logically or Instinctively, Evolution and Consciousness. Personally, I don't usually think of myself as having a brain like a lizard or a crocodile, unless I've had a particularly bad night's sleep, but in evolutionary terms, it seems that I sure do. So, if anyone wants to claim that the way that we think is what makes us human, they'd better try to work out precisely what humans do differently from animals. As I discuss in this section and throughout this chapter, the debate is as much a philosophical one as a biological one. In the first part of this section, I look at how mysterious the inner world of our thoughts still remains, even as scientists discover more and more about the external world. I first of all look at the different tasks human minds and animal minds are asked to do, and then in Jumping to Conclusions, The Cost of Fast Thinking, I'll illustrate how sometimes the two kinds of thinking, human and animal, get muddled up and lead people to make rash judgments and silly mistakes. Buying beans and composing sonnets, contrasting views of consciousness. Do monkeys think? Do plants? No. Or at least not like humans, anyway. They just appear to be thinking as they may follow pre-programmed evolutionary strategies, a bit like computers or Big Brother contestants. But unlike computers, they're undoubtedly conscious of something. For if nowadays scientists agree that the body, indeed the whole universe, is a machine, still no one is quite able to say that a ghost isn't riding along in the center of it. One of the most famous philosophers of them all, Descartes, once wrote, "I think, therefore I am," or at least many people think he wrote that. Of course, critical readers will check such quotes very carefully and find that actually he said something a little bit different. But, as I say, everyone thinks he said that, so in a sense he did. He was suggesting that awareness of the brute fact of existing was the only thing he could be sure of, and he used this nugget not only to get himself up in the morning, but also to make sense of and rediscover the world. Celebrating the Human Mind. I wrote a book a few years ago that was an investigation of consciousness, but went under the rather more appealing title of Mind Games. Through such games, I focused on the mysteries that surround the way people think. The human mind has many inexplicable abilities. It can happily deal with imaginary things that don't really exist, that don't make sense, and that can't be explained. Imagine what a disaster it would be if a unicorn ate this book, or if it turned out your dad was an alien in disguise. Some people even think the mind can project thoughts instantaneously across distances, cause departed souls to rematerialize, and, of course, pass messages directly to a creator God. Yet, although mainstream philosophers and hard-nosed scientists sneer at such irrationality, that's no reason to throw out the distinction between minds and brains, between consciousness and electrical activity in nerve networks. A closer look. The French philosopher was onto something big, and that thing is consciousness, perhaps the central mystery of philosophy. Science can explain many things, but this strange sense of self-awareness it often just dismisses as an illusion. Humans do many things that animals don't, and they do them for complex, socially defined, or aesthetical reasons. As the contemporary philosopher-scientist Raymond Tallis challenges his readers, just consider what's going on under the surface with something as commonplace and seemingly simple as buying a can of beans in a supermarket. Why are people buying them? It may be because they've just seen an advert for it, or because it reminds them of some happy times when they were kids. It might be because they think beans are cheap. Surely animals don't have to worry about things like this when they eat grass or gobble up rabbits. Yet the fact remains that many of the differences between humans and other animals are marginal. The lives of humans and chimpanzees probably looked very similar a few hundred thousand years ago. No tins of beans or supermarkets then, let alone those sonnets and symphonies that philosophers love to cite as proof that humans are something special. Plus, humans didn't develop their mysterious minds in an evolutionary blink. The brain evolved over long periods of time, and so Stone Age people must have had pretty much the same kind of consciousness then. Tip. Professor Tallis is near the mark when he says that what's distinctive about humanity is its social environment, bound together by language and tool use. It's utterly different from the world within which animals exist. Artifacts, institutions, mores, laws, norms, expectations, narratives, education, training. And although humans share 98% of their genes with chimpanzees, they share precisely 0% of their chromosomes, and chromosomes are what actually do things. Jumping to conclusions, the cost of fast thinking. In this section, I'll look at the theory that, actually, people are basically illogical, and because of this, they often get muddled up, make faulty judgments, and silly mistakes. Understanding how people arrive at their opinions and conclusions gives insights into what people say and think, and can even help you anticipate people's behavior and responses in advance. The U.S. professor Daniel Kahneman has written about the psychological basis for judgments, reactions, choices, conclusions, and much more. His writings, such as Thinking, Fast and Slow, give a significant push to the already pretty widespread view of people as basically irrational animals. He was even given a Nobel Prize for his research. Remember, Kahneman's thesis is that the human animal is systematically illogical. Not only do people misassess situations, but they do so following fairly predictable patterns. Moreover, those patterns are grounded in their ancient origins as simple animals. Survival depended on it. Much thinking is instinctive and hardwired. He says that people have two ways of thinking. One, a logical mode, which he thinks is good, of course. Two, an earlier instinctual mode, which he says is the root of most wrong decisions. The human brain doesn't like information gaps, and so people tend to jump at the first answer or solution that looks good rather than take the time to examine all the data, especially in a world where they receive more information every day than they have time to assimilate. Plus, the human brain loves to see patterns and make connections. Although such traits serve people well in many ways, sometimes they mislead people too. For example, thinking is a complex biological process and requires a lot of energy. The human brain uses up 20% of an adult's total energy, and for children, it gobbles up almost half their body's energy. Try multiplying two-digit numbers in your head while running. 23 times 47, anyone? You're sure to slow down both in your running and your calculating. So, because thinking gobbles up precious mental resources, the body is programmed to avoid it. Instead, human beings have developed, over many thousands of years, a range of built-in, off-the-peg methods for reaching decisions. A closer look. You might want to say that the example of the multiplication sum slowing down your running is a bit dodgy. Maybe that it is the distraction rather than the mental energy that causes any slowing down. Certainly, don't accept anything just because an expert says so. However, the notion of being distracted itself indicates a sort of limit in human thinking powers. That's partly why we admire people who can, say, balance on a monocycle on a rope while juggling. The problem with fast thinking, however, is that often it means people don't solve the right problem. They solve the easy problem. A celebrated example is the bat and ball quiz. Try this. Test yourself. A bat and a ball together cost £1.10. The bat costs £1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? Answers at the end of the chapter. Encountering human illogicality, the Linda problem. The Linda problem, one of the most celebrated quizzes in psychological research, is an experiment in unintended bias. It's used to illustrate how illogical everyday judgments are ridden by fallacies anchored in evolutionary history. The original experiment, by two psychology professors, Amos Tversky and Daniel Kahneman, was elegantly simple. At the outset, participants were given this information. Linda is 31 years old, single, outspoken, and very bright. She majored in philosophy. As a student, she was deeply concerned with issues of discrimination and social justice, and also participated in anti-nuclear demonstrations. On the basis of this character sketch, the researchers asked student volunteers to rank the likelihood, probability, of Linda having one of a list of possible jobs, ranging from teacher in an elementary school to insurance salesperson by way of works in a bookstore and takes yoga classes. They had provided a stereotype and waited to see if the research participants would be influenced by it. Jargon Buster. The context seemed to be that of matching a psychological type, as per the short description, to a career choice. By implication, the research was asking the students questions like, "Would you be surprised to find a bright philosophy student working in a bookshop and doing yoga?" Certainly for me, the answer to that is no, and the students were no different. This process, in which people use stereotypes to arrive at conclusions, has a fancy name in psychology called the representativeness heuristic. That's an off-putting term, but it basically just means basing judgments on typical things. People make a lot of decisions more or less subconsciously by applying preconceived stereotypes. Being a psychology experiment, however, the researchers tucked away a sneaky trick. One of the jobs in the list, bank teller, the American term for bank cashier, was entered twice. The first time high up the list, just as Linda is a bank teller, and the second time at the bottom of the list as Linda is a bank teller and active in the feminist movement. A closer look. In essence, therefore, the question being asked of the participants, and that you can ask yourself now, is, drawing on the earlier description of Linda's character, which of these two statements do you think is more likely? 1. Linda is a bank teller. 2. Linda is a bank teller and is active in the feminist movement. Tversky and Kahneman wrote their description of Linda to make it seem highly likely that Linda was active in the feminist movement, but unlikely that she'd have taken a job in a bank. Thus, nearly all the students considered the first option of Linda becoming a bank teller to be improbable. But by linking the unlikely element of the description of Linda to the likely one, the researchers found that a full 89% of students were persuaded that the description, Linda is a bank teller and is active in the feminist movement, was plausible, and certainly much more so than the simpler claim. Yet here's the catch. How can Linda, being a bank clerk of one particular kind, be more likely than her being a bank clerk of all possible kinds? Oops, that's illogical. In fact, as the logicians say, the probability of a conjunction is never greater than the probability of its conjuncts. In other words, the likelihood of two particular things happening must be less than just one of them happening. Your being hit on the head by a flying pig tomorrow is very unlikely. Your being hit on the head by a flying pig tomorrow and getting rained on is a bit less likely again, no matter how rainy a bit of the world you live in. It's kind of an iron rule, like 2 plus 2 equals 4. Don't argue with it. A conjunction is two or more things joined together in some sense, and a conjunct is just one or other of the things. To cut a long story short, simple logic seems to dictate that Linda being a bank teller tout simple is more likely than her being a bank teller and a feminist. But Tversky and Kahneman drew much more general conclusions than just that people don't understand formal logic. They declared that the result was solid evidence of the illogicality of human thinking. The research has been cited many times since to wag a cautionary finger at those who see human beings as rational creatures who use the lessons of experience to learn and improve their navigation of life, and to make most people look dumb instead. However, you don't have to rush to agree. On the contrary, many possible arguments can be made as to why the second description is more likely than the first one, and why that 89% were quite entitled to say so. It all depends on the way words work, which is rather more complex than Tversky and Kahneman, let alone subsequent logicians, seem to have allowed. A closer look. Another possible way to argue for intuition against logicians. Critical thinkers always need to ask why the mathematical model of the probabilities is so at odds with human intuition. Another way of modeling the Linda problem is to argue that when one of the categories includes two pieces of information, by implication, all the categories do too. In this case, by adding "and is a feminist" to the description of Linda as a bank teller, the researchers also added a rider to each of the other descriptions. It might be the implication that she is not a feminist. At the very least, it would be something like, "and there is no information about whether or not she is a feminist." In that sense, as far as these jobs go, her status as feminist or not isn't known. It's undetermined. When no information is available for an undetermined value like this, the conventional way is to make it being true or false equally likely, that is, to compute it with the value 0.5. That's how mathematicians calculate the odds of something that in everyday language is said to be evens or 50-50. With real life being full of uncertainties and many possible career paths being available, Linda's job is very hard to predict, and so all the options must have a very low probability, even her being an elementary school teacher. In those numerical values so beloved of logicians, you can, for the sake of argument, put the likelihood of her being a bank teller at 0.01, 1 in 100, and the chance of her being the teacher at 0.1, 1 in 10. On the other hand, her being a feminist is almost certain. The description makes it so. Call it 0.9, 9 in 10. Thus, the prediction that Linda is a bank teller can be represented as 0.01 times 0.5 equals 0.005, 5 in 1,000, and Linda is a bank teller and a feminist as 0.01 times 0.9 equals 0.009, 9 in 1,000, in which case, unambiguously, the extra information increases the likelihood of the latter option. If the maths is treated this way, then, just as almost all the students insisted, Linda being a feminist bank teller really is more likely than her being a bank teller who may or may not be a feminist. This way of recalculating the options brings the logic into line with intuition, which is how such things should be done, rather than vice versa. I'm not saying it is the right way to look at things, mind. What do you think? Considering the power of group thinking. Consider for a moment, if you'd be so kind, why you're listening to this book. Perhaps it's a project of your own devising to become more logical. Or, on the contrary, perhaps this book is part of a kind of extreme groupthink, brainwashing even, an effort by society to make you think a certain way. Outlandish idea, perhaps, but that's one possible implication Professor Deanna Kuhn draws from her research into psychology and education. She is concerned that, as a society, people spend much of their time and effort determining what they believe, but seem to care little about how they come to believe what they do. Questioning your beliefs. The question as to the extent people are in control of their decisions and the extent to which they simply follow other people is important to Deanna Kuhn. She believes that critical thinkers should see thinking as a form of argument because individuals' beliefs are chosen from among alternatives on the basis of the evidence for them. However, her research caused her increasingly to question the extent to which individuals actually do hold their beliefs on the basis of evidence, instead of as a result of social pressures. Warning. Deanna Kuhn's rather alarming conclusion is that many people don't or can't give adequate evidence for the beliefs they hold. Worse, people are unwilling or unable to consider revising their beliefs when presented with evidence against them. Kuhn holds that reasoned argument requires, at the very least, this ability to distinguish between the theoretical framework and the physical evidence. Jargon buster. Cascading information. Cascade theory is the idea that information cascades down the side of an informational pyramid, like a waterfall. If people don't have the ability or the interest to discover something for themselves, they find that adopting the views of others is easier. This act is, without doubt, a useful social instinct, and an individual relying on information passed on by others is often quite rational. After all, thinking is difficult and energy-sapping, as I explain in the earlier section, Jumping to Conclusions, The Cost of Fast Thinking. Warning. Unfortunately, following wrong information is less rational, and that's what often happens. People cascade uselessly in everyday ways, like so many wildebeest fleeing a non-existent lion. A lot of economic activity and business behavior, including management fads, the adoption of new technologies and innovations, not to mention the vexed issues of health and safety regulation, reflect exactly this tendency of the herd to follow poor information. There are two possible, but conflicting, strategies for coping with the tendency of people to unthinkingly absorb and follow duff information. 1. Some people suggest that society needs to encourage a range of views to be heard, even when they're annoying to the majority. For instance, allowing people to deny global warming or to let teachers decide what they're going to teach. 2. Other people say that society needs stricter control of information to stop the spread of wrong views. This view is the one currently cascading down the pyramid. Don't snack on chips while listening to this. One of the best examples of information cascade is the entirely false consensus around the danger of so-called fatty foods, despite it having no medical or scientific basis. The theory originates to a single researcher called Ansel Keys, who published a paper saying that Americans were suffering from an epidemic of heart disease because their diet was more fatty than their bodies were accustomed to after thousands of years of natural evolution. In the following years, results from 4 other countries appeared to confirm that a high-fat diet coincided with high rates of heart disease. Unfortunately for this theory, prehistoric traditional diets turn out not to be especially low-fat after all, and in the most relevant period of 100 years before the supposed epidemic of heart disease, Americans had actually been consuming large amounts of fatty meat. And so, the epidemic followed a reduction in the amount of fat consumed, not an increase. The problem is that the human brain is quite good at seeing things the way it wants to see them, rather than the way they really are. It can even see patterns in raw data that don't exist. For example, Keyes simply excluded the many countries that didn't fit his theory, like France and Italy, with their oily but healthy cuisine, and the obvious factor for higher rates of heart disease that people were now living long enough to develop heart disease rather than being killed off by things like diseases. But the cascade had started. Soon, despite the protests of specialist researchers about the lack of good evidence, hardly any doctors were prepared to speak out against such an overwhelming consensus. In fact, in recent years, large-scale studies in which comparable groups have been put on controlled diets, low-fat and high-fat, appear to show that the low-fat diet seems to be unhealthy, but no one is quite sure why. So the next time someone says that all the experts agree, even if they're philosophers, Nobel Prize winners, or even TV personalities, don't be so sure that that proves anything at all. Watching how the brain thinks. Wouldn't you love to be able to see a great brain, such as Einstein's, Copernicus's, or Robbie Williams's, thinking? To watch as the neurons spark into action and they solve another mystery of the universe, like, how are space and time related? Maybe the Earth goes round the sun? Or, why don't I have hit records anymore? It's important for critical thinkers to know whether they really can think freely, or are only churning through data, more or less efficiently, in the manner of a very complicated computer. In this section, I look at some of the arguments for thinking that the human mind is actually more complicated than that, and, by implication, capable of achieving more things. My nerves are playing up, the brain at work. Francis Crick, the 20th century British biochemist who played a key.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.